Okay, so yesterday we were looking at compiling and creating libraries. Okay, and you saw the steps that we used for creating libraries and compiling programs. So today we're going to introduce a which makes life a lot easier, okay, for developers, for people who are writing programs and compiling them. So we're going to introduce a make program today, a make program. So why do we need a make program? So you remember yesterday we were talking about source files and creating executables and libraries from source files. You notice that a single program, some project that you're creating, can consist of more than one source file. It can have one or more source files. Now when you're creating a large software project, the number of source files can quickly grow, can quickly become very large. Okay? And you remember that one source file can be referencing a function that's present in another source file. Remember? So one source file could be calling a function that is defined in another source file. And each source file we're compiling into an object file, and then we're using a linker to link up the object files together and resolve any dependencies between them. Now, what happens is that when you have a large project with a large number of source files, you're going to be creating a lot of object files. And these object files are going to have dependencies among them. Now, suppose you create your executable, you built your executable, and you changed one of your source files. Suppose you fixed a bug or added a feature to one of the source files. Now what you need to do is you need to recompile that particular source file into an object file and then relink your executable. Right? So the source files which did not change, you do not need to recompile them because the object files are going to be the same as before. You just need to create a new object file and relink all the object files back into a new executable. Now suppose, yesterday I showed you in one of the examples, there's a header file, right? The stdio.h. So a single header file can be included by more than one source file, right? So one source file, one or more source file, two or more source files can include a header file. Now suppose you had to make a change to this header file. In that case, you would have to recompile all the source files that included this header file once again. You would have to recreate the object files. Okay, so you can see that there's the dependency, as this number of source files become large, the dependencies start to become complicated. And it becomes difficult for the program to keep track of which source files changed and which source files need to be recompiled. Okay, so this process of keeping track of what has changed and what needs to be rebuilt and when does the executable need to be relinked, this kind of becomes complicated for the program to keep track and becomes error prone. Now there's two solutions for this. One solution is that whenever you make a change to any source file, you just recompile everything. Okay, you recompile every source file in your directory so that you make sure you covered everything. Okay, you can do that. But now when you have a really large program, a really large program consisting of many source files, this could mean compilation time like an hour. Okay, you could be spending 1 hour compiling stuff, when actually you just need to spend a minute or less compiling just one object file. Okay, so the solution to this is we use the make program, the make utility. What make does, it automates the task of managing, of tracking changes to source files and rebuilding your executables and object files. So it takes care of tracking the changes and making sure which files need to be recompiled and which don't. Okay? So it removes the burden from the programmer. Now, make is an old program that has existed on older Unix systems also. So there are many variants of make. Floating around. Okay, you might find a BSD make and a System 5 make. Now the version of make that we are talking about is GNU make. Okay, so remember the GNU project? They have made their own version of make. Now some features, although they all support some common subset of the make features, GNU make supports some extra features, just like all the other programs. So you remember awk? The awk we were talking about earlier was GNU awk. So it supported a few features. Remember I told you that you can use fs as a regular expression. Okay, let's come back to this. Now, in order for make to do its job, it needs to have two pieces of information, right? Make needs to know what are the dependencies between source files and object files and executables. Okay, you need to tell make how a source file, which source file depends on which other source files, whether an object file depends on some source files, and which are the dependencies that an executable has. Okay, those things will become clear as we come to the examples. So we need to supply dependency information, one. And we need to tell make how it's going to satisfy the dependency. So suppose a dependency is missing. Suppose a file A depends on some other file, and file A, the second file has changed. We need to tell make how to rebuild the new file. Okay, we need to tell it that suppose a change has happened in one of the files, how is it going to recompile? So in our case, suppose a C file has changed, we need to tell make how to rebuild the object file back from that C file. So these two pieces of information you need to give make. You need to tell it the dependency, you need to tell it how to build its files. Now, we supply this information to make in the form of a make file. Like, so generally you call it, a make file is just a general word. Now the make file, generally you will name the make file either this or this. Okay, you'll name it make file with a small m or make file with a capital M. So these are the actual names of the files. Okay, this is the default file name for a make file. But generally when you say a make file, that can be any file, it can be named anything. Okay, it's just a file that contains rules which are understood by the make utility. But in this case, but by default, make expects that your make file should be named either this or this. Right? So what does a make file consist of? In a make file, you'll find what are called rules. Okay? They're called rules. Now each rule will consist of a target, a prerequisite, one or more prerequisites, and commands. Okay? So we'll look at what a rule looks like. So look at this rule. This is the syntax that you will have in a make file. Okay? You have a target. You can have one or more targets, but generally you'll have one target, a colon, and then a list of prerequisites. Okay, and then commands. Now notice that there's a space over here. So you have a line of target and prerequisite, and the next line is your command. Now this is very important. The white space over here before the commands begin, okay, this white space should be a tab character. Okay, this is compulsory. Okay, this is part of the make file standard. So you can't put a space over here. If you put a space over here, when you run make, it's going to complain. Okay? So you need a tab character over here on the first line after the target prerequisite. Okay, this should be a tab character. So what does this say? What does this rule say? So we have a file called target, and we have one or more prerequisites. What this rule says is that this target has a dependency on prerequisite 1 and prerequisite 2. Okay? So this file depends on these two files. Now suppose this file did not exist, or suppose this file was out of date. How do you rebuild this file? In order to rebuild the file, you're going to use this command. So we're telling make, in case the target does not exist or the target is out of date, we need to rebuild target by using these commands. Right? So let's look at an example. So you remember yesterday's example, we were creating a dynamic library, mymathlib.so. We followed a number of steps to create that library and to link our main program to it. So what did we do? We created some object files, position independent code object files. We merged those object files into a dynamic library using GCC. And then we compiled our main program, linking to our dynamic library, right? Three steps. So let's create a make file in steps to automate the whole task, okay, of compiling that program. So our source code for that example yesterday consisted of three files. We have our main program testlink.c, which used two functions, the power4 and cubed. Remember, it used those two functions, and the definition of those two functions were in these two files. So the cubed function was in the libcube.c file. And the power4 function was defined in this source file. Right? So we have our three source files. Now let's look at a simple make file that we created for compiling. So this make file will be present in the same directory as the source files. Right? And we'll name this file as make file with a capital M. So look at this make file. So you remember the syntax, it's target, prerequisites, command. So what's our target? Our target is test underscore link. This is the name of the executable that we want at the end of compilation. So at the end of your whole compilation steps, you want an executable which is named test.link. So we'll put the name of the file, our target file, we'll put that name over here in the target place. Then you have the colon, and then you have your list of prerequisites. Now when you want to compile test.link, what is the command line you used for that? You use gcc-o, testlink.c and the library, right? So what does testlink depend on? it depends on these two files being present, right? So testlink, in order to compile testlink, you need testlink.c to be present, and you need this library libmymap.so to be present, right? So that's a dependency. That's the prerequisites. Now suppose testlink did not exist, or testlink was out of date, how would you compile testlink again? So that's the command part of our rule. So remember, this is a tab. There's a tab over here. And this is our command to rebuild testlink, right? So this is a command you saw yesterday. GCC, our C compiler, hyphen O testlink tells GCC to produce output file named test underscore link, our source file, our library. Okay. So this is called a target. Now, when you run make, okay, this is our make file, we're done. Now let's see whether how it works. Now when you run make in the directory which contains the make file, when you just type the command make, it automatically searches for a file named make file. Okay? It looks for a file named like this. And once it finds this name, a file, it's going to read the rules in that file, and then it's going to do the appropriate actions, okay, to build your target. Now when you call make on the command line, you can supply a target name. Okay, suppose you had more than one rule, you can tell make which target to generate. Now suppose you did not provide a target, this target is optional. Suppose you did not provide a target, make by default will produce the first target in the list of rules. So suppose you had one rule here and two more rules. If you just type make on the command line, make is going to generate this target, right? Okay, so testlink is our default target for make. So let's do that. Let's go to the directory where the make file is, where our source file is, and we're going to run make. Just type make and enter. So let's see what the output comes. So we just type make on the command prompt. Okay, we got an error from make. So what does make say? Make says there's no rule to make target libmymatch.so, mymap.so, which is needed by testlink, and it stops. So what does this error mean? So if you looked at our source directory earlier, it had only three files. It had the testlink, libpower4, and libcube, right? .c, the three C files. Now, in the prerequisites for testlink, make saw that it saw that there are two prerequisites. One is testlink.c and one is libmymap.so. Now make saw that libmymap.so does not exist. Okay? Libmymap.so does not exist. So one of the prerequisites is missing. So what does make do in that case? What make does is going to search in the make file for a rule which matches this prerequisite. Okay, it's going to see if there's a rule which has a target as this. Okay, it's going to look for a rule where the target is libmymath.so. But in our make file, there's no rule with that target, right? So it cannot find a rule. So that's what it's complaining about. It's saying there's no rule to create the target libmymath.so. So how do we fix this? We'll add a rule. We'll add a rule for creating libmymath.so. That's exactly what we'll do next. I hope this is reasonable. Okay. So we added a rule. Okay, the same syntax. We have a rule and some prerequisites. And this time our target is libmymath.so. So what does libmymath.so depend on? It depends on the object files, right? The PIC object files which we created in the first step. So a library first create the object files, merge the object files using GCC into a dynamic library, and then compile, right? So we're talking about the middle step over here. That's a step where you create libmymath.so. So libmymath.so depends on the prerequisites libcube.o and libpower4.o, right? If these two files are present, you have enough. You can create the libmymath.so, right? So suppose libmymath.so does not exist or if it's out of date, how do we recreate it? So over here we have the command for generating libmymath.so. So the same command we used yesterday. GCC hyphen shared tells GCC to create a shared library. Okay, and this is the option to the linker telling GCC to set the internal name of our library to libmymath.so. The hyphen O option tells GCC what output file name to create. Okay, libmymath.so. And these are the two object files that we want to merge into our library. Right, so we got a new rule for libmymath.so. So now, when make finds that libmymath.so does not exist, it's going to find this rule. and then it's going to generate with my MyMatter.so. So if you run this script, what do you think is going to happen? Yeah, so you'll expect an error, right? Because these two O files did not exist. Right? They don't exist. So we'll have to write some more rules for those two. But let's run this and see what happens. Now, surprisingly, it works. Okay, we got our output. Okay, and if you look closely at the output of make, look at this. Make has already created our O files for us. Okay, it used the same command line we talked about yesterday. It uses CC. CC is just it's GCC itself. It's just an alias for GCC. So it uses CC, C compiler. It uses C option. The C option, you remember, what does C option do for GCC? It produces an object file from a source file. It produces a .o file. So make has ran CC with the -c option. It produced a libcube.o from our libcube.c. It produced a libpower4.o from libpower4.c. Then it created the libmymath using the command which you typed in the earlier rule. Okay, and then it compiled a test link executable. So it worked. Now how did make know how to create the .o file from the .c file? Okay, so it turns out that make, the make command, the programmers of make, have put in some built-in rules into make, okay, for common types, for common file types. Okay, so they put some, the most common rules which are built in. So these are called implicit rules. Okay, implicit rules. You don't need to write these rules explicitly in your make file. So whenever make sees a dependency on a .o file, what it does is it's going to go searching for a .c file with the same name. Okay, when it finds a .c file, it knows that make has an implicit rule on how to generate a .o file from a prerequisite .c file. So it just does that implicit rule. Okay, this is good. But there's a problem. You remember yesterday, when you want to create a dynamic library, we had to compile with the -f PIC option. Right? So make doesn't know that. So it's running the wrong command. It did not supply the option over there. Now there are ways to tell make to add certain options to its implicit rules. But let's ignore that. And instead, let's create our own explicit rule for converting for generating the .o file. So let's add those two rules over here.
The executable that it created now won't work?
It will work. So on Linux, on certain platforms it does work. But it's not guaranteed to work because we did not generate position independent code. So generating position independent code is something that is platform specific. Okay, on some hardware you need to do it, on some hardware you don't need to do it. So it happens to work in our particular example, but you never know. Okay, you could compile somewhere else and stop working. So let's add explicit rules for our .o files. Okay. So what we're doing is we're going to add two more rules for generating our .o files from the .c files, and we just add it to the end of our make file. Now, since you can't see it at the back, I've just put those last two lines on a separate slide. Okay. So remember that the rest of the make file is on top. You just add these two lines to the end. Okay, so look at it, simple rule. We have a rule for our libcube.o file. What's the prerequisite for that? The libcube.c, right? And this is the command for how to generate libcube.o from libcube.c. You have gcc-f, so now we added the option that we need, right? We added the option fpic, and -c option to gcc, and the source file. The exact same thing for libpower4, right? So now let's run make again. So this time, make is not going to use its implicit rule. Since we have an explicit rule present in our make file, make is going to use that instead of any implicit rule. So this time, it does what we want. It's using FPIC option for generating O file. So you can notice that make is doing everything in the right order. So what does our dependency look like? We have our main file. We have a main file test link. Okay, this is our executable that we want at the end. What does this depend on? This depends on test link.c and libmymath.so. Now this in turn depends on these two object files, libpower4.o and libcube.o. libcube.o. Now these depend on their source files. Libpowerful. .c and libcube.c. So this is what our dependency graph looks like. Right? So when make sees a target test link, it's going to go through all this dependency graph and it's going to satisfy dependencies so that your final target is up to date. Okay? So if you create a change over here, it's going to make sure. So you'll see that the commands are executed like that, bottom up. Okay. So you see, it first executes the commands to generate the O files. Then it's going to execute the command to generate your library file. Then it's going to link these two and create. Okay, that's what you see here. So first it's generating .o files. Then it's going to merge the O files into your library. And then it's going to use the library and the main program to generate your executable. So make is taking care of your dependencies, right?
So the main file, I can give the dependency in any order?
Yeah, you can give it in any order. But your so if you're typing make, you need to put your first rule as this one. Okay. Now suppose this is your first rule. In that case, you would have to give the name of this target explicitly when you run make. You would have to run make or test link test underscore link. Okay. So when, if you want to run make without supplying any command line arguments, you have to keep your first rule as this one.
Yes, sure. Make requires all these files to be present in one and the same directory.
You can have it in different directories, but then you would have to change your make file so that it finds your files. Okay, so there are some options to make. Generally, you don't need it to be in the same directory, but in common practice, what you do is you put the make file in the same directory as your source.
What if you have inverted this tree? So you started with the first rule as lib.
So the order of the rules in the file doesn't matter except when you're running make without any arguments. Okay, because it's going to take the first rule as your default target. Now, as long as you specify the target, you can put the rules in any order. Okay, make is just going to look at prerequisites and follow the tree. Right. So now we've created our executable. Okay. So at the end of this make command, you'll have your test underscore link executable present. Okay. And it ran. So you automated your task of compiling. So now whenever you need to create your executable, you don't need to go through all the steps of generating a O file and linking to .so library and compiling. You just run make. Now suppose you run make again. Okay, you have an executable ready, you're going to run make again. Look what happens. What does make say? Make says that test underscore link is up to date. So when you run make the second time, make is going to see that you have specified the target test underscore link. It's going to look at these prerequisites. Okay. It's going to look at the prerequisites and it's going to check if any of the prerequisites are newer than your target. Okay. It's going to look at that. So what does internally, what does make do? It looks at the time. It looks at the modification time of your file. So if it finds that any of these files are newer than this, it knows that you made a change in one of these files. Now in our case, we're running make the second time. So there's no difference in the time. Okay. All these files are older than this. This was the last file we generated. So none of these files, none of the prerequisites, and none of the prerequisites of the prerequisites are newer than our target. So make knows that your file hasn't changed, and it knows that the executable is still the latest one. So it says that. It says test link is up to date and doesn't do anything. It doesn't do any compilation. So this is one example of how it shows how make can save work. Okay, it's not doing unnecessary compilations because nothing has changed. So let's change one of the files. Okay, remember the libcube.c? Let's make a change to that file. So you don't really need to change a file. You can just open it and save it back again. So what happens is its modification time changes on the file system. Okay. So the timestamp on that file changes. So let's assume we edited libcube.c. We did something over there in that file, we saved it. Okay, then we run make again. So look what happens. So make has ran the GCC command to generate the libcube.o file from the libcube.c file. Okay? And then it's created our library, libmymath again. It's relinked our library. And then it created our executable once again. It's relinked our executable. So you'll notice that it skipped a step. Okay? It did not generate libpower4.o once again. Okay? It skipped that step. Why? Because libpower4.c never changed. So the libpowerful.05 we have is still valid, it's still the latest one. So make took care of that. So make avoided an unnecessary compilation. Right? So you don't need the programmer to be checking which file needs to be updated with that. Make is gonna do everything for you. Okay, as long as you specify the dependency and which commands to run. So good. So let's assume we're gonna add two more functions to our libmymap.so. Okay, we're gonna add two more functions. Power 5 and square root. Okay, some hypothetical functions we're adding. And these functions will have their definitions in these two files, libpower5.c and libsquareroot.c. Now let's look at our new make file. What are the changes that will come in our new make file? So the first line is the same because the test link depends on these two files. Now for a library, we have to link these two new files also to our new library, right? We need our library to contain these two new functions. So we'll add the name of those two functions to the prerequisites of libmymap.so. So for the target libmymap.so, we've added libpower5.o and libsquareroot.o to the prerequisites. And in the command for generating libmymap.so, we've added the two O files. Okay. So simple change. And now we've added two extra rules for generating libpower5.o and libsquareroot.o. So I'll just show you the last two lines here. Okay. This is the last two rules of the makefile, just zoomed in. So look, we've added two more rules. We added a rule for libpower5.o. Okay? Exactly same as the earlier one. We just added two more rules. Now notice that our makefile is getting a little long. Okay? It's getting a little repetitive. So look at these four last rules. They're exactly the same. There's no difference. Look at these. Okay? You're using gcc-fpic libpower4.c. Using gcc-fpic libpower5. The only thing that's changing is the file name. Okay, otherwise the rules are just the same. Now suppose you are going to compile this on a different compiler, on a different computer, and instead of fpic, you have to supply some other option. Okay, you'll have to change it everywhere. You'll have to open your makefile. Suppose you have 100 O files. You'll have to change it everywhere. So let's compact this. Let's use some feature of make to make this syntax a little more compact. So what you'll use in that case is something called a pattern rule. Okay, we'll use a pattern rule. So what does a pattern rule say? So pattern rule is a way to tell make how to convert some particular file type to another. Okay. So over here we're telling make how to generate libpower5.o from libpower5.c. Okay. Now a pattern rule will tell make how to generate some particular file type. So we can create a rule telling make how to generate a .o file from a .c file. So a general rule that applies to all .o files. Okay. That's a pattern rule. So we'll create a pattern rule. Now look at this. This is what our pattern rule looks like. Is it visible? It's %.o, %.c. Okay. If you can't see it, it's there on the next page. Okay, this is one. This is the pattern rule that we created to replace those last four rules. So the last four rules, which are just repetition of each other, this is what you replace it with. So what does this pattern say? This rule is a pattern for converting C files to O files. Okay? And it's generating O files from .c files. So what does all this mean? What does that symbol mean? I'll tell you in the next slide. So when you type a rule like this, okay, when you have a rule like this, %.o colon, so this is the target and this is the prerequisite. Now suppose make found that one of the prerequisites like libpower4.o is missing. Okay, it finds that a file is missing, libpower4.o. So now it's going to go searching for a target, libpower4.o, right? But instead of a target, we have a pattern over here. We have a pattern rule. So when you have a pattern rule, so what does this pattern rule say? It says any file ending with .o. Okay? So that matches what make is looking for. Make is looking for a rule for libpower4.o. And then it finds this rule. Now this percentage, if you remove the .o from the name, so libpower4.o, you strip out the .o, what do you have? You have this libpower4. That's called the stem, okay? That's called the stem of the name. Now when make finds a target with the stem libpower4, it's going to search for a prerequisite with the same stem but with a .c extension. Okay. So in this case, it's going to look for libpower4.c. Okay? And if it finds that file, it's going to execute these commands to generate it. Now look at the command. Look at the command for generating the .o file and the .c file. It's exact same command, but instead of the source file name, we've given this symbol here, dollar and less than sign. So this is called a make automatic variable. Okay, the value, this is a variable actually, just like a shell variable. It's similar, not exactly the same. So what does it expand to? So this value, the value of this variable is set by make itself. Okay. So this dollar less than, this automatic variable expands to the name of your prerequisite, the first prerequisite. So in this case, we have only one prerequisite. So it expands to the name of this prerequisite. So suppose make was searching for libpower4.o. It generates a dynamic rule, libpower4.o colon libpower4.c. And what's the command going to look like? It's going to be gcc-fpic-c libpower4.c. Okay, it's going to replace that that variable with the name prerequisite. Right? So now what we've done, this is what our new make file looks like. Okay, we replaced all those repetitive rules, and we replaced it with a compact rule that works for any .o file. Now good. Now again, if you look at this portion of our make file, there's again some repetition. Now look at the names of the O files. We have the names of the .o files over here in the prerequisites. We have the same names repeating here in the command part. Okay, we again have repetition. So how can you cut down on that repetition too? So we'll use variables. Now how do you create a variable in the make file? You use an assignment operator. Okay, in the shell you used equal to, over here it's a colon equal to. Just colon equal to, no spaces in between. This is assignment. So if you want to create a variable, you use this assignment operator. And suppose you want to reference a variable. So by referencing, you want the value of a variable to be used somewhere. You use a dollar brackets and enclose the brackets with the name of your variable. So look at this example. We're creating a variable here at the beginning of our make file. The variable name is objects. So what is objects equal to? It's the name of all the object files that we need. All the object file prerequisites for our library. Okay? We're just storing all those names in this variable. And wherever we need that list of names of the .o files, we're putting a reference to that variable over here. Okay? So look here. We have a libmymath.so rule. Okay, the target is libmymath.so. Instead of listing all the .o files in the prerequisites, we just put our variable there, dollar bracket object. So this expands to this entire list of names, right? And we've done the same thing for the commands. Okay, so instead of writing all the list of .o files, we just put dollar objects there, a reference to the variable.
In this case, all the .o files are going to execute the same command.
Yes. This one.
If I don't want that, I want some specific object files to...
Yeah, you can specify explicit rules. So this is like an implicit rule that works for everything, right? It's a catch-all rule.
Yeah.
And you can specify a more specific
rule. Then which
rule.
One will contradict? If I want a specific command,
if you have a specific rule, it'll probably take the specific rule first. Okay? First specific, then general.
It can be
Yeah, I guess I'm not sure about that, but I'm assuming that if you put in any order, it will pick the more specific rule before it picks a general rule.
Is this objects a keyword, or you can have objects one, objects two, like that?
Yeah, you can. This is a variable name that you choose.
Okay.
You can have any variable name. It can even be lowercase, but generally in makefiles you'll find by convention variable names are put as uppercase. So yeah, you can use any name over here, as long as it's a valid variable name. Now, whenever you need to, so what's the advantage of having this kind of construct? Suppose you need to add five more functions to your libmymath.so. Okay, some new math function that you discovered. You need to add them. So the only change you need to make to your make file is you just need to add their names over here to this first line. You don't need to change anything else.
Okay.
The whole compilation process is going to run by this link. So whatever new C file you created is going to be taken care of by this rule. And whatever O files you list over here is going to be merged into your math library over here by this rule. And your executable is going to be linked correctly. Okay.
Excuse me. Here, percentage.o is there, right?
Yes.
Last line.
This one?
Percentage.
Yes, percentage. Yes.
But then, do we need to have
object files in that
folder?
No, you don't. So when does this rule apply? The rule applies when either the object file does not exist or if it's out of date.
Means it generates from all C files or.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Like there will be like so suppose there are so many .c files.
Yes.
Does it generate .o files from all C's or?
No. So if you have a O file listed in the prerequisites, only then it's going to search for a C file which is matching to that. So suppose you had a C file, something else, okay, .c presenting a directory, but you did not add the corresponding .o name over here, it's not going to compile that C file into a .o file. Okay? Now you can write a rule which will compile all C files in your directory into O files. Okay? So that's a wildcard rule, but generally this is what you want. You want to just explicitly.
You've defined the objects as the first line.
Yes.
Can I just define it before where I use the object?
Like yeah, you can define a variable anywhere.
Anywhere.
It doesn't have to be at the beginning of your make file. But you'll find variables usually defined at the beginning.
Yes.
It's just convention. It's just good style. So I think you're beginning to see the advantage of using a makefile when you have a large project, a lot of source files.
Okay.
Now there are some other automatic. So we've covered this automatic variable, the $, which expands to what the first prerequisite, right? Now there are quite a few other automatic variables that make understands. We'll list two of them over here. So there's one called $add. Okay, what does this expand to? This expands to the file name of the target. So over here, this is our target file name, this is our target file name, these are our target file names. So $add is going to expand to that name. And suppose you have more than one prerequisite. Now, I told you that $less than, okay, $less than, that only picks the first prerequisite, the first prerequisite. Suppose you want all the prerequisites, you should use this, the $caret. This expands to all the files in the prerequisites. So now let's use these two in our makefile to make it a little more compact. Now look at the rules now. So we change this line. So look at our main line, test link. The target is test link. The dependency and prerequisite are testlink.c and libmymethodso. Now our GCC line to generate our executable has become this. So what does $add expand to?
Test link.
Okay. So over here we're going to have test link, GCC hyphen O test link, and $caret is going to expand to all the prerequisites. So it's going to expand to testlink.c. Live my method. So you made it a little more compact. And over here also, we wanted the name of live my method so as the internal name for a library. And we also wanted it as the output, the name of the output file for GCC. So we've substituted $add over there. Okay. So this is what our final make file looks like. Right? Now there are some targets, there are certain targets you can add that don't really generate a file. So you notice that this target, when this rule is executed, if it executes successfully, you're going to have a file present in a directory, a new file. You're going to have your executable present, right? If this rule executes, you're going to have libmymethodso in your directory. And if these rules execute, you're going to have .o files. So generally, you'll find in make that a rule generates a file. Now you can create some rules which do not actually generate any files. Okay. You can. So how does the file become? How does the file get generated over here? What happens is if the file is missing, okay. If the file is missing, make sees that the file is missing and it's out of date. So what it does is going to execute this command. So this command is what actually generates this file. So GCC is going to produce this output file, okay. And then it's going to compare the time. So GCC is looking for this file. When you run this rule, GCC is looking for this file. If it finds that this file does not exist, or if this file is out of date, it's going to run this command. Now, it is this command that actually generates this file, right? This command, the output of this command is this file. Now, the output of this command is libmymethodso, the same over here. Now, you can create a rule that does not generate any file. Okay? You just write a rule which has a command which does not generate any file. Now, a common rule you'll find, so we call this a phony rule. Okay, it's a rule which does not produce any file. The common rule that you'll find in many makefiles is a target called clean. Okay, the target is clean. So what does a clean target do? If you write make clean, so you can type make in a target. Suppose you type make clean on the command prompt. What it does is it's going to remove all the .o files, all the .so files, all the executables from your directory. Okay, it's going to clean up your directory so that it contains only source files. Okay? So what is this clean, make clean target used for? It's used for, suppose you want to rebuild your project. Suppose you want to rebuild your program completely from scratch. Okay, you don't want any previous O files or previous SO files to be used. You want to build everything from scratch, from the C files. In that case, you would run make clean and then run make after that. So once you've removed all the O files, make is going to start doing the whole dependency thing again. It's going to generate all the O files from C files and compile them together. So we'll add a clean rule in our make file. So what would it look like? So this is a clean. This is a rule for clean. So you can see that the target is clean. It has no prerequisites. Okay, there are no prerequisites for it. And this is the command that's going to run. Okay. We're going to remove all .o files. We're going to remove all .so files. And we're going to remove our executable. Okay, this is the command. Now, as long as you don't have a file named clean in your directory, what's going to happen if you... So this command, does it generate a clean file? It doesn't, right? It doesn't generate this file. So no matter how many times you run this rule, this target, you're never going to get a file named clean in your directory. So since clean file never exists, this rule is going to always be out of date. Okay? So what did I tell you earlier? When you look at make, make is going to look for a target. If the target is missing or the target is out of date, it's going to execute this command. So clean is never going to exist. Right? So clean never exists, so it's always out of date. So make finds that clean file does not exist. So whenever you run make clean, it's going to execute this command. Right? It's going to delete all the O files, SO files. Now there's a problem. Now suppose by coincidence you had a clean file in your directory. You had a clean file in your directory. In that case, make file is going to see that the clean file exists. Now since clean does not have any prerequisites, okay, it does not make, so what does make do when it finds prerequisites and a target? It's going to compare the modification times and see which one is newer. Now, since we don't have any prerequisites, clean is always up to date. Okay, clean is always up to date because there's nothing compared to. In that case, no matter how many times you run make clean, it's never going to execute these commands. Right? So how do you tell make? So how do you tell make that this clean is not a real file? Don't look for a real file, it's just a phony target. Okay, phony means something that's not real, a phony target. So in that case, you add this rule, okay, the phony rule. Okay, you add a dot phony, colon, this is a target, your target is dot phony, and you add the prerequisite as the rule which you want to tell make is not a file. So you want to tell make that don't look for a target called clean in the directory, it's just a phony target. So you give phony and you give the prerequisite as this rule. Yeah, this is in the main file.
Make file.
It's in the make file, yeah.
But
so I'll show it in here. This is a whole make file.
Okay.
You put it there and begin.
So, as these all commands are going to run, so every time you just make a command, run as a make, just if you make, won't it run the task command as well?
It is not in any prerequisite.
I'm sorry, which command? This one.
Yeah, I mean, just like.
Oh, make does not run these commands. So, this is not like a script. Okay, these are not scripts, these are rules. So what happens is, when does make execute the command in a rule? When it finds that the target is missing. Okay, only then is that rule run. Okay, so none of these rules have clean as a prerequisite. Right? None of these rules in this file depend on clean. So the clean target is never reached on normal execution. If you run make, just make, the clean target is never reached. So if you go in the dependency graph, clean does not come over there. Right? So clean command is not executed. Now if you want to run explicitly this clean rule, you have to write make clean. And then we're telling make that the phony target is there. Okay? So it does not, even if you create a file called clean in your directory, the make clean target will still work. So that's a phony target.
Sure. If by mistake clean is at the top, is the first
rule? Yeah, if it's the first rule, then yes. It's going to execute make clean as a default. So you need to make sure, you need to be careful which is the first one. So yeah, so like Kanjan said, if your clean rule is the first rule, whenever you type make, what's the default rule? the first one. So it's going to run the make make clean. So you need to be careful. You need to put your high level executable as your first target. Okay, your first rule.
Can you explain the phony how it is stopping that clean?
Now, when you have a rule like this, a target is a file. Okay, and you have prerequisites, those are also files. So how does it decide whether a rule needs to be executed or not? It looks at the file that is specified by target, and if that file is older than any of the prerequisites, it's going to execute the rule. Right? So in case you had a file named clean, okay, so this is going to match a file. So make sees that clean exists. So it's going to compare it with the prerequisites, but there are no prerequisites. So it's going to consider clean as up to date, because it's newer than no other file. Okay, so it considers up to date. In that case, it does not execute these commands. So that's not what you want. When you want make clean, you want it to remove all these object directories, right? I mean these files. So in that case, you tell phony dot phony clean and give this command. It tells make file to ignore that file. Okay, so whether the file clean, whether the file named clean exists or not, it's going to run this. It's not going to check whether this exists. Okay, it's just going to treat this as a rule name, just as some phony target. Okay, a target which does not have a real file to match. Okay, that's all. Okay, so I wanted to tell about how to compile programs from source. So we're done with make. I just wanted to tell you how to compile programs from sources. So before that, since we have some time, I'll just show you one more example for make. So you notice that the make file consists of rules which look for files and they look for prerequisites. Now, most of the time, okay, almost all the time, you'll find make is used for generating executables or libraries from source files. It's used for compiling stuff. Okay, so suppose you have Fortran or C or any other language. Okay, you can create a make file to convert that source into an executable or some line key. But you can see that the make file is actually very general. The make command is general. It can work for anything. Okay, whenever you have some target which needs to be generated from some source files, you can use a make. It doesn't have to be a C program. It doesn't have to be a Fortran program. So I'll show you an example where we are doing something general which is not related to C. So look at this directory. We have three subdirectories in this directory make unit. There's a destination directory, and there's a source directory, and we have two scripts, and we have our make file. Okay. Now if you go into the source directory, okay, you see some familiar files, our fruit files. Okay. So we have all our fruit files here. We have, I think 100. We have 100 of them. We have 100 fruit files, and each of them contains some names of fruits in some order. Now, what we need to do is, you remember our unique fruits program from the first class, from the first scripting class? We want to run our unique fruits program on each of these files, okay, so that the output is becomes unique. We remove duplicates. And you want to save that output into the destination directory. Okay, simple. You want to run the unique fruit program on these files and save the output, which has duplicates removed, into our destination directory. So the unique fruit script is the same. The script is the same, no changes. Okay, you remember this. Now there's two ways of doing this. One is we'll create a script which puts everything in a loop. Now you'll have to try to remember what you learned in shell scripting. We have a shell script over here. So you have your shell script. What does this do? For in file in source slash star, what is the source slash star, what does it expand to? Every file in the directory source star. Source, right? Every file within this directory. This expands to the name of all the files. Now we're looping over that every file, okay? So in file is going to be set to the first file, the second file, okay? Up to 100. So for each file, we'll echo this line, okay, telling us which file is being processed. And then we're going to run unique fruits on that file and redirect the output, okay, into a file with the same name but with a dot out prefix, suffix. okay, the same name, so suppose it's fruit2.10, we're going to output the file to fruit10.txt.out, okay, and but we're going to put in the destination directory. Okay, so this is a loop. So let's run the script. What does it do? Okay, it's going to process all the files and generate them in destination. Okay, very simple script. So if you go into destination, all the files are going to be there. Your files with a duplicate remote, but with a .out extension. Now this is good. It does its job. Now suppose you changed one of the files. Suppose you edited the contents of one of the files in source.
Can you just show this?
Okay, so the script file is not the focus of our thing, right?
No, no, but like I was just looking at how you directed your output to destination
folder.
Okay.
Okay.
What is
base name?
Yeah, so
base name is the keyword.
Yeah, so what does base name do? Base name is a command. So okay, I'll show it to you. Maybe then it'll be clear. So suppose you type base name slash home slash hr. Okay, some file, okay. Base name gives you the last thing, the last word after the final slash. Okay, it strips out everything before that. Okay. Now if you wanted everything except the last file name, you would do diagonal. Okay. So this is a command for splitting path names. So it again it illustrates that toolkit philosophy. Okay, you have some program which does something really simple. It just strips out the path name, but that's what we're using in the script. Okay, coming back to the topic. So suppose you had to change one of the files in your source directory. Suppose you added a fruit or a couple of fruits into one of the files. You would run your whole unicast script again, right? So you run the script again. It's going to do the whole thing again. It's going to process every file. Now, we don't want that. We just want to process the files which are new, right? Which are changed. So we'll do the same thing in a make file. Now before I show you the make file, just warn you about the first line of the make file. It's a little complicated. Maybe I won't explain it now, but I'll tell you what it does. Okay, what this first line does. So you remember there's a variable assignment. Okay, there's a variable assignment. So what this line does, it's going to look for every file in the source directory. Okay, it's going to look for every file in the source directory. It's going to add a .out extension to it. Okay, it's not going to actually add a .out extension. It's going to take the names. Okay, it's going to take the names of all the files in the source directory, add a .out extension to it. Okay, and add a dest slash prefix to it. So what is dest slash? It's just telling a directory. Okay, so you'll have something like. What does this line do? It takes any name like this. Source slash fruits10.txt. Suppose you had only two files in your source directory. So this is what it would expand to. And fruits11.txt. So what this command does, it's going to take this name, okay, strip out the source and the text, and it's not going to strip this out. It's going to convert this into this. It's going to add this prefix. fruits.txt and add the suffix .out to each of the files, okay? To each of the file names. So dest slash fruits.txt, fruits11, there's no fruits10, .out. And once it's done with this, once it's done adding the prefix and suffix to all the names, it's going to store all those names in that variable, okay? So what is target going to contain? It's going to contain all the names of the files in the source directory after they've been translated to this. So what is this? This is our targets, right? These are the files we want at the end of our operation, right? At the end of our rule, once we're done processing. So when you run the unicast script, what does it do? It takes these files and generates this file, right? That's what the script does.
Python
the txt. Yeah, so txt is still there. We're just adding it as a suffix, dot out. So the unicast script does the same thing. It takes these files and generates this. So what we're doing is we're looking at all the files in the source directory and generating the names of the targets. And we're storing the name of all the targets over here. Okay? So just imagine the targets contains the name of all the files that we want at the end of our Unicas running. Okay. So forget that. Now let's look at the rest of the file. We have a target called all. We have a target called all. And the prerequisites for the all target is the name of all our files which we want to attend. So we got all our files in the destination directory. We're setting that as a prerequisite for all. So when you run make all, right, when you run make all, what does it look for? It's going to look for presence of all those target files. Okay, if any of those. So when it finds that a prerequisite consists of a target file, it's going to go searching for a rule to generate that file. So suppose a prerequisite does not exist. Okay, it's out of date. It's going to search for how to generate that target file. So it comes to this rule. Okay, this is our pattern rule once again. So look at this pattern rule. We have dest. Can you see it? Can you see it? Do we need to switch off that? Okay. So we have a pattern rule dest. Okay, dest slash, that's our directory name. Percentage, our stem, and this is our extension, .txt.out. Okay, we have a stem and an extension. So this is a target. And you generate this target from the corresponding source file. Okay, source slash the same stem .txt. Okay, the same stem .txt. So make is going to find this prerequisite is missing. It's going to come to this rule. Okay, it's going to find that that particular file does not exist or is out of date. It's going to go to the source directory. Okay, it finds the prerequisite there. Now it's going to generate that file. Because it's out of date or does not exist, it's going to generate that file. So how do you generate the file? The same thing as our script. We'll run dot slash unique fruits. What does dollar less than expand to?
Three.
The first prerequisite, right? The first prerequisite. So this is our prerequisite. Okay? And dollar add expands to the name of our target. So it's just the same line as our script. We're using dot slash unique fruits, dollar less than, and we're redirecting the output to our target file. Okay, so we've done our make file. So let's see how the make works. Now we'll go to the destination directory and remove everything over there. Okay, we removed everything. Now let's run make. So make is running unique fruits for all the files in our source. Okay. Now if you go to destination, all the files are there. Right. Now let's go to the source directory, cd source. And let's change one of the files, like fruit11.txt. Okay, we'll add something here. We'll add a mango over there. Okay, so we change fruit11. And we'll go to the directory which contains the make file again. And type make. So this time it only generated that, it updated the fruits11 file. You know, this is exactly what you want it to do. Now suppose you went into the destination directory. Okay, I'm going to use fruit. What does this do?
20 to 20.
Yeah. That's a character class. 0 to 9. What does 0 to 9 expand to?
Only 1, 0, 1, 2, 3.
Any one of the characters, 0 up to 9. So this is going to expand to all the files fruit 2, 0, 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3. Okay, so it's going to remove all the 20 to 29. Okay. Now we'll go to the directory contains the make file again. And we'll run make. Okay, it's going to generate only those files back. So the reason I want to show you this is that you can use a make file for anything. Okay, it doesn't have to be C or Fortran. You don't need to be using GCC or GFortran. It can be any operation where you just want to perform operations on files that have changed, files that need to be updated. Okay, so that's what this example is for.
It suppresses the echo thing in
Sorry?
It suppresses the processing file name method.
So inside the make file, we're redirecting the output to echo make file. So inside the make file, we're redirecting the output to an output file. So it never comes to the screen. Right? Standard output is redirected to a file. Now if you didn't have this, it's going to be coming on the screen. So I want to tell you about compiling programs from source, but I think we're running out of time. So maybe I'll try it in the next class.